Hello everyone, thank you very much for your time and presence. It is our privilege to have you all join today. We welcome everyone to the webinar, an overview of OPC US security. My name is Zeeshan, I take care of digital marketing here at Uttunga. In today's webinar, we will share the importance of security in OPC UA. We will also cover security objectives and solutions for common attack types. Finally, recommendation from our specialist for using OPC UA in a secure manner. Before we get started, I would like to take a couple of minutes to introduce Uttunga. Next slide. We are a product engineering and industrial solutions company. For over 13 years, we have partnered closely with industrial OEMs to build products and solutions from concept all the way through the lifecycle of the product. Our engineers have added digital layers to mechanical, non-digital field devices, built configuration calibration software, highly sophisticated data integration, visualization and analytics solutions, provided consultation and services on industrial security and quality engineering. We offer services in application development, embedded services, IIoT, and verification and validation. Our services are targeted to OEMs and end industries in process, factory, and power domains. We follow a strict secure development lifecycle for all our projects. Next slide. These are the few industrial consortium we closely work with on connectivity and protocols. Field asset connectivity is a foundation for Industry 4.0, and that's how we started as a company about 13 years ago. That is connecting field device assets to hardware and software system up in the value chain. Our association with this consortium, and importantly the OPC Foundation, is rooted in our commitment to help our customers build interoperable industrial systems. Next slide. With that, I would like to introduce our speaker for today. Sahan is a cybersecurity specialist. He plays a critical role in secure SDLC and secure DevOps implementation at Uttunga. Sahan has over 6 years of experience in industrial and security domain. His proven areas of expertise are security testing and strategy, endpoint security, ethical hacking, VMware visualization, EFDT DTM, and OPC UA. Just a few quick housekeeping points before we get started. The duration of the webinar is 60 minutes. We will utilize the last 10 minutes for Q&A segment. Please send in your questions using the Q&A icon on your left-hand side of your screen. The presentation slides and the link of the webinar recording will be emailed to you post the webinar. Request you to click on the full screen icon on the left-hand side of your screen to get the good view of the slides. Before I hand it over to Sahan, a quick poll for 30 seconds. Request to attendees to please drop in their answers. So the question was, which of the following products do you supply or use? So most of the audience have selected OPC US server or client on the embedded devices. Moving on. Thank you for your answers. Without further delay, I would like to hand it over to Sahan now.
So thank you, Zizan, for your kind introduction. So welcome all to the session. So before we are going into actual topic, let me talk a little about IIoT enablers and Industry 4.0. So nowadays we hear and see a lot of use cases about IIoT and the way the instruments and sensors are connected, interconnected, and how other devices network together and with computers and industrial applications. However, if we see it from a technical front, the IIoT enabled by technologies such as cloud computing, edge computing, mobile technologies, 3D printing, advanced robotics, big data, Internet of Things, and many more. And of course, backed with cybersecurity. Let's move on to the next slide. Some of you might be already aware about OPC UA, and just to give a little intro, The OPC UA is a machine communication protocol, machine to machine communication protocol for industrial automation developed by the OPC Foundation. And it is based on a client server communication, which focuses on communicating with industrial equipment and systems for data collection and control. This guy over here, I mean the OPC UA, is selected as a backbone of the German government driven Industry 4.0 program, so which targets to increase flexibility and interoperability in the production automation environment. To boost to that, OPC UA serves as a common data connectivity and collaboration standard for local and remote devices in IIoT, in machine to machine, and Industry 4.0. If you see the right hand side of the picture, the OPC Foundation has a wide range of collaborations with different groups, organizations to come up with companion specification and to promote interoperability seamlessly. Ultimately, we can say OPC UA is one of the game-changing fundamental element of Industry 4.0 that can revolutionize industrial automation capabilities from the field device to the enterprise level. I love this line over here. So most of the times in open platforms, I always start with communication requires more than connectivity. And I believe it's completely true, because we are in the era of digitalization and almost everything is interconnected and intercommunicated. So it is highly critical that the connectivity and the data exchange that happens between A to B or B to A to be secured and reliable. In the upcoming slides, let us see how OPC UA enables security. So this will be our agenda for this session. So we will try to understand what OPC UA is focusing on from a security perspective. Then let us try to understand the security pillars and what OPC UA supports. Then discuss about OPC UA security architecture. Then try to understand the secure data connectivity across the firewalls. Then security policies supported by OPC UA. Later on, attack types addressed by OPC UA and its effectiveness. And finally, we will look into a recommendation from an OEM and end user perspective. When we talk about data security, three aspects come into picture. That is data at rest, data in process, and data in motion. So data at rest is something like data stored in memory. Maybe something like it is stored in hard disk, historian, or stored in some other way. Data in process, something like how the data is processed when the applications are using it. And the final one is data in motion. Basically, what it means is how the data is transferred from one point to another point. So these are the three primary aspects which should be secured when we are talking about data security. For us, from an OPC UA perspective, data in motion is the one the OPC UA is primarily focused on. It focuses on security measures needed to authenticate, security measures needed to establish the trust between A to B, and how the data is transferred securely between A to B. Whenever we talk about security, there are many standards, practices, and recommendations specific to domain in the current era. And if we drill down all of them to basics, they focus on the below security objectives and concepts. Or I'll put it in this way, like Whenever security professional evaluates how secure the system or application is, basically he or she will look into this concepts, that is CIA triad and AAA framework. CIA triad, that is confidentiality, integrity and availability, is about information security, like trusted information. Confidential is nothing but data is only visible to intended recipients, that is authorized recipients, legitimate users. Integrity, so data is sent as is without any modification. For example, data sent from A to B is not at all modified. And the next one is availability. Data is available to authorized people when they are in need of it. So whenever you request for some data, you should get appropriate response during that period. And the other key concept is AAA framework, that is authentication, authorization, and auditability. Some people call it as accountability as well. So where all this stresses towards access control. Authentication is about identity of the user or application or a system. So authorization is about controlled permissions for access roles based on the access permissions based on the roles. And the final one is auditability, where all requests, response, and recipients will be documented from a log perspective. So when we see some of the industrial protocols, they are not designed with these core pillars in mind. So ultimately, when we see OPC UA protocol, it is built with this core security concepts in mind, which makes it secure, reliable, and more preferable. With this, let us get into our OPC UA security architecture. So OPC UA security architecture uses layered security, that is transport layer, communication layer, and application layer. Basically, we have a transport layer to swap the information over the network, which is done over TCP. The layer over here is flexible to swap. In case of PubSub, it will be using MQTT to publish the data. And if we are using HTTPS as a transport, then data is already encrypted using a TLS. Otherwise, the OPC UA provides a capability to encrypt the data, which is built into the OPC UA specification. Okay, once the transport layer is established, then it is going to create a channel. So basically, the channel is something where the client and the server trust is established based on the application certificates exchange. So using a PKI mechanism. So once this trust is established, it will stick to a symmetric mechanism where the keys are known to each other, and based on the session keys, it will start communicating each other. The communication layer also ensures the confidentiality and integrity of the messages based on the policies selected while establishing the connection. Once a secure channel is established, we can have a multiple sessions where application layer comes into picture, which needs to be authenticated and to be authorized to decide what information is going to exchange and who is allowed to see what and who is allowed to do what. This is how the structured OPC UA builds up the security in these layers. From a user point of view, you will have a OPC UA client to connect to the server, where you add a connection address, where we have to add an endpoint address with a port and select the policies with username and password to establish the secure connection. And before that, you need to ensure that the application instance certificates are exchanged each other in a trust zone. Either it is done manually or automatically. And Next slide will be on OPC UA secure data connectivity. So most of the industrial networks are built on ISA 95 and the Purview reference model, which segments different equipments, devices and networks into regions that is separated via firewalls and DMZs. OPC UA supports secure communication in and between each network layer, that is from shop floor to enterprise level, which is enabled the use of most appropriate communication technologies like TCP, UDP and MQTT. So what I mean is the OPC UA can be integrated into small devices or powerful systems which sits in any of these layers from level 0 to level 4. So if you see the table over here, the mechanism, client and server mechanism, is using a TCP transport with two-way interactions between a client and server, which typically used on LAN and can be used on WAN and can be used in firewalls as per the restrictions, which we will be discussing in the next slide. And of course, the communication is secured end-to-end with the encryption. So the other mechanism would be PubSub, which is basically a one-way communication where we are broadcasting the data outside the DMZ, and any of you using for a cloud, then you will be using a MQTT transport to broadcast the data, which works very well with the firewalls. Overall, like, the OPC UA is structured well to support a different transports and end-to-end secure communication. Let us see how OPC UA data exchanges across the firewalls. So if you see the best IT practices, they are recommended to close the inbound firewall ports. So as this minimizes threats of external attacks, and even the security organizations specifications like NIST and NUC are instructing the members that all the inbound firewall ports to be closed to minimize the threats. So classic use case will be that server resides in a secure area, maybe at level 3, which is protected by firewalls whose inbound ports are closed. So the what OPC UA is that does is it introduces a reverse hello capability here. So which allows the OPC UA server to initiate a communication with the OPC UA client via outbound firewall port. So once the OPC client acknowledges the recipient of the reverse hello, secure communication between two components can be achieved. So ultimately, the OPC UA reverse hello security feature allows the functionality that is demanded in the current business days. So and allows it to be highly secured way communications. So though the inbound port remains closed, we are able to establish a secure communication between the OPC UA client and the OPC UA server. Then let us see what are the security policies supported by OPC UA. So the one better thing in OPC UA is that it considers the need of resource constrained devices too, and provides the flexibility to choose among security policies based on the profile selected. Some devices may don't have a computing power to do algorithmic calculation, and some might be capable of signing or maybe used only for low bit encryption. So OPC UA allows us to use a policies based on the security levels and the security goals. So apart from this policy, it also supports the security modes where you can also select mode as a none, sign and encrypt. So the servers are actually capable of supporting all these policies. As an end user, we need to identify and know which one to be used based on the requirements. So for now, OPC UA recommends a basic 256, SHA-256 algorithms, and also AES, RSA algorithms, basic 256 and basic 128 RSA-15 algorithm is already deprecated. And in terms of a PubSub, it supports a PubSub with a 128-bit and PubSub AES with a 256-bit. And one important thing to note here is OPC Foundation deprecates the security policies and updates the support for a policies to maintain the effectiveness of a security. So it keeps on updating the specification based on the new security innovations that comes up and new security algorithms that comes up, which they think it is pretty important in terms of communication and the data exchange. So with this, let us see what are the security solutions that are supported for a different attack types. So when we see a security control like encryption, by having the encryption in place, the data sent over between A to B or B to A cannot be sniffed. So basically, the data encrypted and it will be in an unusable format. So in case I'm performing a man-in-middle attack, though I am able to see the data passing over, but I will not be able to decrypt it because I don't have a key splitting. With this, it OPC addresses attacks like sniffing and eavesdropping, so which impacts the confidentiality directly. And the next one is message signing. Message signing helps to ensure data integrity, message authentication, and non-repudiation. Basically, the data cannot be altered between, as it looks for integrity and a proof of origin of the messages. So ultimately, with message signing, it addresses attacks like message spoofing, where I cannot falsify the data as a legitimate data, and also cannot perform a message alteration attacks because it is the messages will be signed and encrypted. So not only a message signing, additionally the messages will also validated, and messages will also contain a valid session ID, secure channel ID, request ID, timestamp, and a sequence number which shall be validated whenever the communication happens between a server and client. And the next one is application authentication. So basically, OPC UA performs authentication in two levels. That is, one is user authentication and the other one is application authentication. So to establish the secure channel first, it needs the application to be trusted. In case of OPC UA, certificate exchange shall happen to establish a secure channel, which we gonna see in the next slide. Basically, what I mean is, to trust each other, both needs to know each other, which is done via certificate exchange in this case. With this, whenever a rogue client or a server try to establish the connections will be automatically rejected because the corresponding certificates are not part of their trust list. So if a client is trying to connect a server, if server doesn't have a certificate, application instance certificate of a client, then automatically it rejects the connection. So to perform any attack, it needs to be profiled first. So with profiling with so-and-so information to mount a more intrusive or a damaging attack, which avoided with very limited information exposure in this case. Because if I'm not an authentic, trustable application, then I'll not be allowed to expose. Then the server automatically will not allow to expose the information to the client. So it needs to be trusted to ensure some data is exchanged between them. And the next one is user authentication and authorization. Typical user authentication mechanism, which supports user and password, tokens, and X509 certificate exchange, and it also can be integrated with Active Directory in the enterprise level. So in terms of authorization, we can build access permissions based on the roles to each OPC object, like operator and a plant engineer can have a different access level based on the use cases and based on the context of the plant. So we can have a granular level of access for a specific tags, methods, and operations. So you can have a access level till each tag group, each device, each channel, and all this can give a access level of read write, where browsing permissions to each tag can also be given based on the group that the permission group and the permissions that we make up. So having the authentication in place, it avoids attacks like rogue server and session hijacking attacks. So next one will be availability. So attacks like denial of service and distributed denial of service are protected by design, where the packet processing is very minimized before it is authenticated. And also from a connection point of view, so if I have to launch a distributed denial of service attack, so I need to connect with multiple clients where I keep on flooding the data and try to ORAM the OPC UA server. So in this case, OPC UA servers gives the functionality such as number of connections, subscriptions to the server shall be limited based on the requirement. And also we can configure the alarm incidents. So in case if we feel that there is some suspicious activity happening, it can raise the alarm based on the incident that happened. And the next one will be auditability. OPC UA supports a lot of use cases, like we can aggregate different servers and establish different sessions for a channel with different vendors. So if there is a lot of connections, data exchange, and lot of communication happening in between, so it is important that we monitor and track who is doing what and from which address it came from and what they have done actually. So either you can use this functionality for a diagnosis, or you can have a setup to monitor a suspicious activity with connector, server, and devices. So basically the audit logs can be tracked for all the connections, actions performed, and the values that are changed. And those logs can also be forwarded for post analysis and forensic analysis, especially with something whenever something goes wrong. And let's talk about certificates in this slide. Like, we will see the overview of how certificate exchange and handling is done. So OPC UA uses X509 certificate standard, and we can use both a self-send and CA certificate. Initially, to establish the secure connection, the public key of a client and a server is exchanged each other, which is done manually, or it can be automated, but the recommendation is to exchange the certificate manually in this case. So during a connection, if the certificate exists in the list, then the secure channel will be established. Otherwise, it will be automatically rejected. So in case if the trust is established, then typically it uses the server's private key to decrypt the encoded message. So, and from a certificate management perspective, so there are a couple of use cases as well. It's like manual distribution mechanism, custom distribution mechanism, and automatic server certificate management, where which you can achieving using a global discovery server, which we are not talking in this slide. So let's see the effectiveness of OPC UA security analysis. So if you see the table, so these are the typical attacks types in the first column, and other columns indicate which aspects of trustworthiness being attacked. So actual testing and analysis was done by a third party team for a German federal government to ensure that this is not just on a paper, and when it is implemented, how effective it is. And as per the analysis result, it passed all the tests without any issues. And this chart over here shows how secure the communication is when you select a security mode as sign or a sign and encrypt. So green indicates the highest of security and the red indicates the lowest. So of course, selecting a sign and encrypt will have a effective protection in terms of confidentiality, integrity, and authenticity. So without further delay, let's see the security recommendations for OEMs. So define and include the security specific for OPC product or application. So if you are planning to build an OPC into your product, and you have to identify this, first you have to identify the security goals, like what encryption algorithms to be used, what kind of authentication needed, and without having a clarity of security goals, so it might be difficult to come up with the hardware compatible resources, because the moment you choose the encrypt function, crypto functions, then the device computing power shoots up like anything, and so the device computing and the calculation needs more power than the usual security calculation, usual power. So next one will be like choose a right SDK. So based on the requirements defined in the first pointer, so you have to choose the right SDK. Like if you are really looking for a scalable one, that you are, then you have to look for the one which supports all profiles like nano, micro, embedded, and standard. And again, it depends on the kind of requirements and the business goals. And also, in case if you are planning to build an SDK or application in a you try to use a programming language where maintaining scalability and quality should not be a difficult task. So like based on the experience, most of them recommend a C++, then on that they try to build a wrapper using a C# or Java or something like that. And the next one will be secure SDS, secure development lifecycle. So ensure that whenever you are building the OPC UA in a secure in your organization, it has to be built in a secure manner with having certain practices in place, like secure coding practices as per the CERT or OWASP standards, and performing a static analysis and dynamic analysis on the products. And few, of course, the few other checks as per the secure development lifecycle process. And third-party libraries for OVM perspective. So while you are building the product, ensure you are doing a secure composition analysis. For example, you might be using the OpenSSL, Embed TLS, Log4Net, and maybe other third-party DLS. So it is very important for you that you do a security composition analysis so that these third-party libraries are understood well and analysis you do an assessment for the vulnerabilities. And moreover, you can also identify the license terms for the distribution. So in order to, if you are building a third-party libraries, if you are using your third-party libraries in your product development, it is very important that you understand the license terms of this library so that it can be distributed. And the next one will be a secure storing of private keys. So if you are building the product, then you have to provide the capabilities to store the certificates securely. So in case of a device, you can use a TPM, a hardware-based storage like TPM and a HSM. And in case of a cloud, you can use a key vaults to store those private keys, which will be as secured. So you have to keep in mind, like whenever you are building up, so you have to also give a secure space to a private, to store a private keys very in a secure manner. And the next one will be certificate and user management workflow. So it is very easy to use, but security workflow for a certificate management and user account management should be defined and implemented. So a well-defined workflow reduces the need for troubleshooting and brings down the support and dependency on us. For example, customers keep on calling that how to exchange the certificate, how to generate the certificate. So to avoid such kind of incidents, so you need to establish the proper workflow and proper functional perspective. And you have to manage the workflow totally in such a way that it is very usable for a customer to generate a certificate or in terms of exchanging the certificate. And next one is like get certified by a foundation test lab. So once you have built the OPC with whatever the profiles are based on the requirements, so the profile can be a nano, standard or embedded, ensure it is certified, which automatically increases the trust and confidence to the customer. So it is possible to have a customization in the profile and look for a certification. For example, you can have a nano profile with a transport security built in and ask for a certification body to certify the OPC product. Next one, like security specific upgrading patching from a OPM perspective. So you have to design your product or application to accept independent security patches and upgrades without interfering with existing running functionality. So this will help end users in protecting themselves against new threats and be up to date without worrying much about downtime. Like if I have to update the application to add a new crypto libraries, then it should be updated without much downtime. So today OPC spec recommends so and so libraries, and tomorrow it comes up with a new library. Then when you are building a product, and it should be designed in such a way that the update should go as is without any much interruption in the current runtime. And of course, will be other general security aspects from a device specific point of view. So you can have a security boot implemented to ensure the security, ensure the integrity of a firmware. And also, you can also ensure unused ports are locked, especially a debug ports are locked and closed. And if you are thinking about a PLC or a device, you can limit the number of connections and data subscriptions to the PLC or a device. So as per the based on the requirement or as per the use case, because if some clients configured badly, then it might overwhelm the memory. So because if the clients are configured badly, like it starts sending a request to your PLC or a devices, then if your device is not capable to handle those responses, I mean the request, then it overwhelm the total total PLC memory, and it will be unavailable to the users. So next one will be like security recommendation from a end user perspective. Of course, offer a certified products or application that supports a required security policies. So what happens is having the certified products can help an end user to reduce their system integration cost, because it assures it compliant with the OPC specification, and it assures it is interoperable with the other OPC products from other vendors, and it ensures the robustness, so reliable and able to recover from a lost communications. And from a user perspective, of course, it follows a universally accepted best practices, and it will be more efficient. So if you are buying any OPC product, if it is certified, it will be more efficient in terms of managing a resource, a memory, or a disk space. Because if the product is already certified, then the product is already tested in terms of interoperability, in terms of robustness, in terms of usability, and also in terms of efficiency of a product. So next one will be security specific upgrading and patching. We also spoke about from a OVM perspective how it has to be designed, but from an end user perspective, patch management has become one of the major aspects in security. So it is important to understand and know the strategy of a vendor to patch the product of independent security patches and upgrades without interfering the functionality of a downtime. So whenever you are buying the product, OPC product from a vendor, so you have to ensure that what kind of patching mechanisms and the strategies that they have built in. So what is the strategy in case of some security patch is released, and how it is going to impact our downtime in the plan. So this kind of a strategies are very important in terms of plan. So it is very much required to ensure that these strategies are built in whenever you're buying a product. Next one will be like certificates and user account management process and guidelines. So we spoke about building a workflow in terms of a product, and from an end user perspective, so it is important to have a policies defined to handle the certificates and end user management. So they must have a policies who should install a certificate, who should change the certificate, and who should perform what actions, and based on the roles, what permissions to be given. So these processes and should be ensured, and defined. And the next one will be secure storing of private keys. So we already discussed from a OVM perspective that it needs to provide a capability to store it. So if from an end user perspective, if you are storing the keys in a file system, so it is mandated that the appropriate read-write permissions are set. So you have to ensure that permissions are set to a legitimate users, and only legitimate system processors should be able to access the private keys. So or you can also use a local certificate store or a Windows certificate store. So in case of a device, you can use a hardware-based storage like TPM, HSM, and in terms of a cloud, you can use a key vaults to store those private keys. And the other one is like support. Yeah, it is very important that there is a vendor support whenever you are buying a OPC product. So as an end user, from an end user perspective, so apart from a cost and performance, vendor support is one of the major things. So in case of handling a technical issues or a vulnerability issues, so before buying a product, try to understand what kind of patching and vulnerability handling procedure is defined for the product, and so on. So and there will be like other general security aspects from a security from an end user perspective. So I'm not getting into details of this because as based on the organization, if you have adopted to a such a, some so and so ISMS, then they will have a policies defined and the hygiene's defined, and also the network communications policies should be will be defined, access level will be defined. So those will be a general security policies or a recommendation practices that you should follow from an end user perspective. And let us see and how to use OPCA in a secure way. So first thing will always be, do not leave your secrets lying around. So as we already discussed, if you are storing a private key or certificate files, store it in a system with a permission, where a permission you provide a permission to a legitimate user where only he can access, not the unintended user or attackers or someone else. So and next one will be, do not automatically trust the certificates. So do not accept the connections which do not provide the trusted certificates. So automatically, whenever you establish a client to server connection, so automatically the connections will be rejected. Then you have to exchange the certificates between a client and server to establish the trust between each other. So that is a one point. And then from a user authentication, so there is an option to connect without any authentication. So always ensure you are using a username and password or a certificate based authentication, which will be very easy to trace from a auditability or accountability perspective. And the one is like security mode none, which should not be used. Of course, it does not provide any protection. And the security mode, you should be always a sign and encrypt or a sign if your device is not providing so-and-so computing power, then you have to opt for a sign. And otherwise, the primary recommendation will be using a sign and encrypt for while establishing the connection. Then the security selection of a cyber cryptographic algorithm. So at a minimum, the security policy is recommended is like basic 256, SHA-256 should be chosen because it is more secure compared to other policies. And so weaker security policies used and outdated algorithms which are already deprecated in from a security specification point of view, which should not be used. And whenever also you are choosing an application to OPC product to buy from a so-and-so vendor, so ensure that it supports the latest algorithms as per the OPC specifications. And next one will be managing and maintaining certificates. So use a certificate trust list and certificate revocation list to manage validate certificates. Of course, we discussed there is already use case to manage the certificates automatically, where you can have a global discovery server built in and you can have a mechanism to manage and issue or revoke the certificates based on the use cases of a global discovery server. And in a nutshell, OPC UA is secure by design. So most of the security aspects are built into the specification, where each profile provides a security capability. Either you choose a nano, embedded, or standard. So in case of a nano, it provides the capability of username and password. And in case of embedded, it provides some transport level security. And standard will give all the policies, whichever we have discussed in the previous slides. And next one will be like OPC allows different levels of security. So we observed already that OPC UA uses a layered approach to structure the trust, and we also saw that it can fit into a different levels from a device to the enterprise application. So and the OPC UA specifications are designed by industry experts and with, from a multiple company, so it is more secure by design and more reliable. So it OPC UA also provides a defense in depth. So when you see this picture over here, it provides a defense depth level of security where like transport level security is ensured, and you can also restrict the data flow and information model access control based on the user or a role base. Those can be achieved, and of course we saw the accountability where audit logs can be built in based on the use cases. And from an availability perspective, we saw like we also spoke about like it is possible to limit the number of connections, and also it limits the number of data processing. It limits the data processing before the connection is established. And from a security maintenance and incident handling perspective, so it also gives a flexibility to have a global discovery server, so that provides the pull and push management mechanism to provision the certificate or update the trust list or revoke the trust list or renewal the expired certificates or whichever the certificates that are compromised. So overall, when you see this OPC UA protocol, it gives you a defense in depth approach. So it starts with the application, then a transport, then it ensures the communication between A to B is encrypted, and the transaction happens between A to B is secured. So, and also it also understands this from a scalability perspective. It also understands what is required from to have, if in case of multiple clients and servers are there in a plant, it also understands how the certificates can be managed, how the multiple servers can be managed. So in those perspective, we can use a global discovery server. And finally, as a security professional, security as a reminder, so OPC UA alone will not secure your system. So we saw the typical Purview model in the previous slides. So you need to have a certain security layers here and there. Maybe a firewall, instant IDS systems, and maybe you can have a diodes for a one-way communication. So and also from a system perspective, you need to have a application whitelisting, and you need to have a antivirus built into a system. So those things has to be taken care. Yes, from a OP, when it comes to a protocol perspective, OPC UA gives us all the necessity required, all the security features that is required in the current era. Okay, this is all I have for this session. We will try to address a possible questions. If not, we'll drop a mail to your questions. I'll hand it over to Zishan.
Thank you so much, Sahan, for the detailed content. I request the attendees to please drop in the questions using the Q&A icon in the left-hand side of your screen. And also, we are also at the mark of 60 minutes, so I request the attendees for extending for 5 more minutes. Sahan, you have some questions here.
Yeah, so I have a question related to embedded. So the question is, like, in the embedded implementation, can we use IIS security allowed by OPCS standard, or there is a limitation? Again, it depends on the business requirements and the use case. Of course, it gives based on the profiles that you have selected. It gives you the capability to have a security at each security at a transport layer, or you need to build in username and password or something like that. So it again depends. So you can have a customization, as I said, like Nano. You can have a Nano profile where you can built in. You can also build a transport level security to it and opt for a certification, product certification. Okay, there is one more question. So we have a good software developers in our team who can integrate OPCA into our product line. However, we are not security experts. We don't understand the crypto and other complicated terms. So what else does OPC Foundation provide? I am assuming some basic guidelines on security implementation are provided by OPC Foundation. Yes, from a specification point of view, yes, there is already a specification defined, like, not purely on the implementation perspective, but in terms of security, what kind of security policies that you have to use and what kind of profiles you have to use. So overall, I could say it gives a good level of knowledge where easily any engineer can grasp it with some help from a security expert, and they start building on the security into their OPC UI application. So there is one more question. Under what scenario would the OPCA server initiate the connection with the OPCA client? I'm referring to reverse hello that you mentioned. Under what scenario would the OPCA server? Yeah, so in case if I have a DMZ or a firewall built into my Purview model, and so the initial policies will be that I should not allow my inbound port. I should not open my inbound port. So in order OPC UA to client to connect to OPC UA server, you need to have a inbound port. But what OPC UA does is, instead of opening inbound port, so it gives you a flexibility to have a reverse hello connection where you need not to open the inbound port, and so using the outbound port, it will initiate a connection with the OPC UA client, and then the security and secure data communication will be established between client and the server. And it answered your question.
Yeah, Sahan, I think it's also time up, so let me take it over.
Yeah.
So thank you for your questions and participation. There are a few questions I guess we will not be able to answer now due to the time constraint. We shall answer the remaining questions via email soon. So before we move on, let's have a quick poll for 30 seconds. Request the attendees to please select your answers or options. So I've got a mixed response. All the audience have gone for all the options. So what is the level of competency on your OPC UA security within your organization? So all the audience have it's common. So thank you for your answers. So we would like to support you to evaluate and implement the right OPC fit into your product or solution. please reach out to us at contact@utunga.com. I repeat, contact@utunga.com. Thank you everyone for participating in this webinar. We hope it added to your existing understanding on OPC US security. I will quickly share an update on our previous and upcoming webinars. We recently concluded a webinar series, a sequence of 6 webinars on various aspects of OPC UA. You can view these webinars on our YouTube channel. Search for Utunga in YouTube search bar. You will find us. Navigate to the OPC UA Inside Out playlist to access the recordings. We are covering a very relevant topic, FDT OPC UA webinar on September 30th, which is 2 weeks from today. FDT is a technology for integrating field devices like flow meters, valves, etc. to the digital ecosystem, and OPC UA plays a key role in FDT. Please block your calendars. We'll share the registration link shortly. Finally, do follow us on LinkedIn, where we share all the latest information and our ongoing activities there. So stay safe. Thank you.